Hello, welcome. Let's talk about Shallan Devar from The Way of Kings. There will be big spoilers for The Way of Kings. So if you have not read that book, you should not watch this video because you're going to have some major things spoiled for you. When we first meet her, she's already on a Thalen sailing vessel chasing after Yasna Kolin. And so when we meet her, she's sitting on a ship. She has her sketchbook in hand, and at this point when we meet her, we don't know about any of the trauma in her past. We do know that her father is dead. We know that there's people after her family's debts, and she and her brothers are doing all they can to save their family. And that's why she is on this journey. She has this plan that she came up with, that she had to sell to her brothers, that she is going to go find Yasna, become her ward, steal the soul caster, trick people into thinking they still have wealth, and somehow everything's going to work out okay. Yeah, Yasna calls her on that later and says, "What were you thinking?" But taking this course of action and doing this takes courage. She is 17. She's going places she's never been. She's never traveled. She's never been out alone, and here she goes. She does catch up with Yasna. She finds her. She talks to her, gives her her letter, and kind of has a bit of a confrontation with her. And Shallan is highly non-confrontational. She hates confrontation. This is where we start to peek into her past a little bit and see what kind of man her father was. The kind of man that made her afraid to be confrontational. Yasna is nothing compared to Shallan's father. But even so, when Yasna turns Shallan down the first time and the second time, her inclination is to give up. And this is where she gets to start to show some of her grit and determination and courage. Because even after being turned down twice by Yasna, she still does what she can to try to become Yasna's ward anyway. She will not let her brothers down. And you know, I was thinking about Shallan and about things she might be feeling. I bet Shallan feels like her art is one of the only good things about her. One of the few things she really excels at. This is my selling point. I do art. This is what I can do. This is what I can say, hey, look at how amazing I am because of this thing that I can do. You know what Yasna doesn't care about? Shallan's art. She ends up having to sell herself on other points. And one of the things that really impresses Yasna is the fact that she is self-taught. Their family couldn't keep a tutor for her because of her father's temper. They all got chased away. So if she wanted to learn something, she had to teach herself. And that impressed Yasna. This is something that makes her willing to take Shallan on as her ward. And in the end, she kind of just wears Yasna down. She just keeps coming back and she just keeps talking to her. And eventually Yasna's like, okay, fine, you can be my ward. Something else we quickly learn about Shallan, even from the first chapter that she's in, is that she likes to talk. She likes to say the first thing that comes to her mind. She loves witty wordplay, and the more witty, the better. To the point that she tries a little too hard, and to the point that it can get her into trouble. A tendency to speak without first thinking about what you're saying is not going to impress Yasna, because Yasna has no patience for people who don't use their brains. But just because Shallan likes to speak before thinking doesn't mean that she doesn't still think. She has a very good mind. Her arguments have good points, and she earns some respect from Yasna for the way that she can hold her own in a debate with her. So Yasna takes on Shallan as her ward, and Shallan's life is starting to look kind of nice. She really loves this being in a different place from the home she grew up in. She's getting to do something she's passionate about, which is studying and learning, and she kind of wishes that it could just continue and keep going, and she wishes that her wardship was real. She's starting to wish that she didn't have to betray Yasna. That's kind of looming on her mind. She knows she has to. That's why she's here. So she's not going to turn her back on doing that, but now she's more reluctant to, and she's starting to feel pretty guilty that this is her plan. So life is finally going good for the first time ever, and she wants to delay ruining it because she knows betraying Yasna will ruin it. And as Shallan spends time studying and spends her time in the Pelennium, she meets a boy. Unfortunately for Shallan, she is so inexperienced, more inexperienced than girls her age normally are, because she has been so sheltered. This relationship that she develops with Kebzel is so new to her. She's never had anything like this before. It's an impossible match, but she feels drawn towards him anyways. It's so easy for her to fall for him. And if you've read this book twice, like I have, the first time when she's kind of falling for him, it's like, oh, this is so sweet. You know, they're not going to be able to end up together. Maybe he'll leave the Ardentia and they'll run away together. I don't know. Maybe it'll end up working out okay. But then on your second time through, when you know that he's only after her to get to Yasna, and you're just thinking how despicable he is, this is not so sweet anymore. But Shallan doesn't know that. She just knows that he's young, he's handsome, he's paying attention to her, he's making her feel like she's important. He's interested in her art. He's interested in the things that she has to say. He makes her feel kind of special. And also, there has to be a little bit of teenage hormones going on. I know in this world she's considered a grown woman, but she is still a teenager. Out for the first time, the first boy that really pays attention to her. She's falling hard, and it's not that unexpected. Now, Yasna has decided that it's time for Shallan to have a philosophy lesson and learn some harsh moral truths. And she really wants to force Shallan to think about hard things. So, you've read the book, you know where I'm going with this. She takes Shallan out to the streets. They are the bait to draw on these criminals. Yasna knows they're going to be there. And here's where her lesson comes in. She soul casts them, kills them, murders them, and does not feel bad about it. And that is her lesson to Shallan. Who was wrong? The criminals who would have done horrible things to them, or Yasna herself? Having to think about all this really upsets Shallan. She wants things to be all neat and tidy. Here's the law. Someone breaks the law, they get their consequences. It should be easy, right? Things aren't that easy in real life. Things don't just work that way. If it was that easy, people wouldn't keep disappearing in that alleyway. But Shallan feels angry. She can't believe Yasna just did this. This shocks her. She's being forced to confront questions that she's never had to before, especially never so gruesomely. But in a way, she's no better than Yasna. Didn't she kill her father, who killed her stepmom? We don't know this yet when this happens, but I have to wonder why Shallan is struggling with this so much. Maybe because she herself did something similar and she doesn't want to have to confront that about herself. But it solidifies her decision to betray Yasna. It will be so much easier now to steal from Yasna and betray her, because now she feels justified. And later, she actually feels more guilty about having stolen it in anger than about the morality of having actually stolen it. So at this point in the book, she's having a huge inner struggle. She loves the way her life is right now, this little pocket of goodness that she has as Yasna's ward, but she's already betrayed Yasna, and she has to think, would I be willing to stay here with her, knowing I had betrayed her? Could I live with that guilt every day? And she decides, you know what? Yeah, I could. She could live with the guilt if it meant being able to stay here with Yasna and learn. Then we get a little more into some of the magic and weirdness that's part of these books. So Shallan is drawing a picture of Kabzel. She's never drawn him before, and he sits for her. And as she's drawing him and not thinking and getting really into the emotions of what she's doing, her drawing has these weird things. She gets up and she runs. And as she's running away, she's sketching as she runs, and they're still there, and they're following her, and they're chasing her. And I have to say that this part of the book freaked me out when I was reading it. I don't like scary things. I don't like scary stories or scary movies. And this was scary enough to me that it creeped me out. Then after this moment of running away from these creatures and she makes it back to her room safely, she accidentally goes to Shadesmar and she accidentally soul casts. And it would have been a bigger moment for her personally in the story, but Yasna is coming. She can't let anyone know that she just did this. She needs to keep this a secret. She just soul cast blood. She panics. What can she do? Oh, slice my arm. Let blood go everywhere. That'll hide it. So now everyone thinks that she has attempted suicide. And boy, does this mess up Yasna. She feels really guilty now. She knows that she can be harsh and hard to deal with, but she never thought that she was so harsh that she would cause someone to contemplate killing themselves. She has come to care for Shallan. She can't stand the thought that the way she treated Shallan could have made Shallan feel that way. Now, we know that that's not really the way Shallan felt, but she can't really fess up to Yasna unless she wants to give away all her secrets. And Shallan, of course, is feeling more guilt because of the way Yasna is feeling, and she knows she's the one who's at fault for it. And while Yasna is visiting her in the hospital, she gets another visitor, Kabzal, come to check on her and bring bread and jam as usual. And this time, he gets Yasna to eat some. And it turns into a little bit of a desperate situation. Yasna is obviously not poisoned. Shallan and himself obviously are. And he has to find a way to get the antidote to himself and Shallan. And you have to wonder if Kabzal did in some way actually come to care for Shallan a little bit, because why else would he be so desperate to get the antidote to her? But in order to save Shallan, she is forced to confess to her crime. Yasna has to soulcast her, but she needs a jewel. Shallan has one from the stolen soulcaster, and she has to say, here. She's ruined all her family's plans. She can't save her family. Yasna has let her go. Kabzal is dead. Although she tells herself, I never really had Kabzal in the first place anyway. And she's just laying there so dejected and so sad. No one comes to the hospital to check on her because nobody cares. She's feeling really alone right now. And in addition to the guilt of betrayal, she is also really sorry that she let Yasna down. Yasna had real faith in her. And that's really disappointing to let somebody who believes in you down. And as Shallan is just laying there in her misery, she realizes something. Why wasn't Yasna poisoned? She starts to realize the truth and she goes to confront Yasna. But at this point, Shallan is not afraid. She's not afraid of the confrontation anymore. She just wants to know the truth. And in this confronting of Yasna, we, the readers, learn a very powerful truth about Shallan. This is where we finally learn that she killed her father. I'm really bad at picking up on hints and clues, and so maybe a more perceptive reader would not have been as surprised, but when I found out that she is the one who killed her father, I was in shock. But that is the truth that gets her into Shadesmar to prove to Yasna that she knows what Yasna can do. And so again, Shallan kind of forces Yasna to take her on as a ward, but this time becoming her ward is so much more important. There's bigger picture stuff going on and the stakes are higher and Yasna knows it. But besides that, I think the best argument she made to Yasna to take her on again was telling Yasna that she can be somebody who knows. Someone that Yasna doesn't have to lie to. And I think that was really tempting for Yasna. Young, naive Shallan is finally somebody she can share with. The one person who will believe her and be on her side. And Shallan becomes part of something so much bigger than she could have possibly imagined. And if you have read book 2, Words of Radiance, you know that there is so much more to Shallan than what we get to see in only the first book. So there will be more Shallan videos coming up, as well as other Stormlight Archive characters. So subscribe to my channel to see more character studies from science fiction and fantasy. Follow me on Instagram, and I'll see you next time. Bye! My husband left his phone in here. He's gonna get notifications that I'm going to have to edit out. Oh, there, the heat went off.